Greetings, everyone, and welcome to Ebenezer Baptist Church on Fraser Street, Vancouver. We're delighted that you could be with us today as we return to online services only in light of the second surge of COVID-19. And as always, we want to assure you that as we conduct these times of worship, we are remembering you wherever you are, and you are in our prayers as we work through this together. As we gather for worship, we begin with some verses from Psalm 103. May they be our call to worship. Praise the Lord, O my soul, all my inmost being, praise his holy name. Praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion, who satisfies your desires with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. I will exalt you, O Lord. Let's pray together. Loving God, we thank you for this reminder that in the midst of all the turbulence and change and anxiety caused by the current pandemic, you remain the same. You are our Holy One. You bring us benefits. You forgive our sins. You heal our diseases. You can redeem our lives from the pit, even crown us with love and compassion, and satisfy our desires with good things. So wherever we are, together, as we take part in this worship, we ask that you would move among us by the power of your Holy Spirit, that you would strengthen and encourage us, that you would lead us closer to you, and touch our hearts where we most need your healing grace, as we commend this time to you, Lord. May you be glorified and your kingdom extended in our midst. In Jesus' name, amen.
We're going to sing a classic hymn, O 4,000 Tongues, which is number 62 in the hymn book, if you're following that way. O 4,000 Tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise.
Joy. believe he is the Son of God. I believe he died and rose again. I believe he paid for us all. And I believe he's here now, standing in a Son of God. I believe you died and rose again. I believe you paid for us all. And I believe you're here now. Standing in a
speaks, he carries my healing in his hands.
There is a truth older than the ages. There is a promise of things yet to come. There is one born for our salvation, Jesus. There is a light that overwhelms the darkness. There is a kingdom forever reigns. There is freedom from the chains that bind us. Jesus, Jesus, who walks on the waters, who speaks to the sea, who stands in the fire beside me. There is a name I call in times of song and comforts in the night. There is a voice that calms the storm that rages. He is Jesus, Jesus, who walks on the waters, who speaks to the sea, who stands in the fire beside me. He roars like a lion, he bled as a lamb, he carries my healing in his hands. Jesus,
Messiah,
Messiah, my Savior, there is power in your name. You're my rock, my redeemer. There is power in your name, in your name. You walk on the waters, you speak sea, you stand in the fire beside me. You roar like a lion, you bled as a lamb, you carry my healing in your hands. God, you walk on the waters, you speak to the sea, you stand beside me. You roar like a lion, you bled as the lamb, you carry my healing in your hands. Jesus, there is no one like you. Jesus, there is no one like you.
Our reading for today comes from 2 Kings chapter 5, verses 1 to 16. Now Naaman was commander of the army of the king of Aram. He was a great man in the sight of his master and highly regarded, because through him the Lord has given victory to Aram. He was a valiant soldier, but he had leprosy. Now bands of raiders from Aram had gone out and had taken captive a young girl from Israel, and she serves Naaman's wife. She said to her mistress, "If only my master would see the prophet who is in Samaria, he would cure him of his leprosy." Naaman went to his master and told him what the girl from Israel had said. "By all means go," the king of Aram replied. "I will send a letter to the king of Israel." So Naaman left, taking with him 10 talents of silver, 6,000 shekels of gold, and 10 sets of clothing. The letter that he took to the king of Israel read, "With this letter, I am sending my servant Naaman to you, so you may cure him of his leprosy." As soon as the king of Israel read the letter, he tore his robes and said, "Am I God? Can I kill and bring back to life? Why does this fellow send someone to me to be cured of his leprosy? See how he's trying to pick a quarrel with me?" When Elisha, the man of God, heard that the king of Israel had torn his robe, he sent him this message: "Why have you torn your robes? Have the man come to me, and he will know there is a prophet in Israel." So Naaman went with his horses and chariots and stopped at the door of Elisha's house. Elisha sent a message to him and said, "Go wash yourself 7 times in the Jordan, and your flesh will be restored, and you will be cleansed." But Naaman went away angry and said, "I thought that he would surely come out to me and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God, wave his hand over the spot and cure me of my leprosy. Are not Abana and Pharar, the rivers of Damascus, better than all the waters of Israel? Couldn't I wash in them and be cleansed?" So he turned and went off in a rage. Naaman's servants went to him and said, "My father, If the prophet had told you to do some great thing, would you not have done it? How much more then when he tells you, wash and be cleansed? So he went down and dipped himself in the Jordan 7 times, as the man of God had told him, and his flesh was restored. And he became clean like that of a young boy. Then Naaman and all his attendants went back to the man of God. He stood before him and said, now I know that there is no God in all the world except in Israel. So please accept a gift from your servant. The prophet answered, as surely as the Lord lives, whom I serve, I will not accept a thing. And even though Naaman urged him, he refused. This is the word of God.
Let's bow our heads. Grant, O Lord, that in the written word and through my spoken words, we may see and behold the living word, in whose precious name we pray. Amen. According to an article in the Chicago Tribune, Kevin Bohr has his own country, and he'd prefer that you call him His Excellency. If you've never heard of the Republic of Molossia, that's understandable because it consists of Bohr's 3-bedroomed house and his 1.3-acre yard just outside Dayton, Nevada. He has a space program, a model rocket, reported the Tribune, a currency pegged to the value of chocolate chip cookie dough, a railroad model size, a national sport, broom ball, and in his landlocked desert region, a navy, which is an inflatable boat. Bohr, a now 58-year-old father of two, is what's called a micro-nationalist, the newspaper continued, one of a wacky band of do-it-yourself nation builders who raise flags over their front yards and declare their property to be, as Bohr puts it, the kingdom of me, the kingdom of me. He sees all this as a fun joke, of course, and he explores it in some detail, including on his Micronations website, where he declares his full title, for example, and I quote, as His Excellency President Grand Admiral Colonel Dr. Kevin Bohr, President and Rais of Molossia, Protector of the Nation and Guardian of the People. But it's a joke that also illustrates a major problem, because we can all struggle with a concern to build our own kingdoms wherever we are, if you think about it. Pride and insecurity surely lie at the heart of most issues of control, self-centeredness, or self-aggrandizement. But recognizing our pride and letting it go can be easier said than done, especially if our sense of self is caught up in false or exaggerated ideas of who we really are. In our modern image-conscious age, there can also be a lot of stress on keeping face, looking tough or cool, so we're not exactly encouraged to show weakness or to admit that we need help. And men can have a particular problem in that area. The trouble tends to come when we find ourselves in situations where we really need to reach out to others for help. I would suspect that many of us have been through times when we've had to swallow our pride. I know I have. But it's not always easy, is it? Yet it's often only when we're prepared to make ourselves vulnerable that we will find the help we need. And this is not just true in our human relationships. As our reading from 2 Kings chapter 5 reminds us, God doesn't play favorites. God's love and compassion extend to everyone. But God will sometimes strip us right to the core and uncover our deepest hurts or problems before bringing lasting healing in our lives. Let's start with a little historical background to our text. It's about 850 BC, and Joram is king of Israel, ruling out of Samaria. 2 Kings tells us that Joram is not as corrupt or sacrilegious as his father Ahab was, but he has serious shortcomings. And just as Ahab faced the prophet Elijah, Joram is now confronted by Elisha, Elijah's successor. Elisha will eventually appoint another to seize power from Joram, but initial relations between king and prophet are quite good. We learn from the early chapters of 2 Kings that Elisha plays a vital role in advising Joram on diplomatic and military matters, for example. It's also clear from 2 Kings 5 and 6 that Israel is now on hostile terms with Aram, or Syria, which is where Naaman comes in. Aram is engaged in fighting a series of skirmishes with Israel, and one of her most powerful leaders is Naaman. 2 Kings chapter 5, verse 1 describes him as commander of the king's army. In North American terms of rank, we might like to picture him a few years back as a sort of General Colin Powell or Lewis Mackenzie of his day. Our reading tells us quite a lot about Naaman, not just what he is, but how he is and why he needs Elisha's ministry. First, verse 1 informs us that he's not only the king's commander, he is a great man and in high favor with his master because by him the Lord had given victory to Aram. Naaman then is a mighty soldier and a victorious one, a man whose achievements match his public standing. Second, Naaman's position is accompanied by great material resources. Not only does he have a household with servants like the young girl captive from the land of Israel, who features in this reading, he has acquired sufficient means, verse 5 tells us, to take 10 talents of silver, 6,000 shekels of gold, and 10 sets of garments on his journey. Those figures may not mean very much to us, but on a rough conversion, just the amount of gold and silver would be worth more than $20 million in current markets. The third thing we can observe about Naaman is that despite all his position, his privilege and his wealth, he is an ordinary human being just like the rest of us. Naaman is subject to normal frailties, and he has one serious problem in particular. According to verse 1, he is ill with a skin disease, which the New International Version of the Bible translates as leprosy. Now, this may not be the once fatal condition that we now describe by that name, but it's at least a very serious skin condition. It's obviously also of great concern and discomfort to Naaman. The only possible cure lies in the realm of the miraculous, and it's to that to which he now turns. For Naaman is also a fortunate man. despite his illness, because he has in his own household someone who can point him in the right direction. We learn from verses 2 and 3 that a young servant girl from Israel has heard of the prophet Elisha in Samaria, so she suggests to Naaman's wife that the general should visit him. Lacking alternative solutions, and no doubt somewhat skeptically, verse 4 tells us that Naaman responds to this advice and seeks the king of Aram's permission to make the journey. In verses 5 and 6, the king immediately refers Naaman to his counterpart in Israel. He also writes with the somewhat embarrassing suggestion that his majesty might take the matter into his own hands. But eventually, in verses 7 and 8, Elisha comes to the rescue. The prophet offers to heal Naaman and thus to prove the validity of his ministry to both a foreigner and an enemy. It's in the account of Naaman's actual encounter with Elisha in verses 9 through 16 that we can observe the fifth and most dangerous aspect of Naaman's makeup. For his pride fuels expectations that are not matched by Elisha's ministry. As he tells Elisha in verse 11, Naaman has come expecting an immediate and straightforward cure. As he makes clear in his offer in verse 15, he's also anticipated a fairly businesslike transaction for which Elisha would be amply paid. Yet here lies the rub, the problem for Naaman in his pride. The slum district of Manila was already overcrowded, but back in 2004, a gold rush only made it worse. It all started, according to a press report, when then 15-year-old Alfredo Gallo, who was combing the riverbed that runs through the Philippine capital, found nuggets of gold. His father immediately sold what he'd found and bought a television and a bicycle, according to local news reports. Then once word got out, hundreds of people flocked to the banks of the filthy river looking for the precious metal. Although the river was polluted and strewn with garbage, many people came to see it with new eyes. As one commented, "It's a puzzle. All we got from this before was trash. But now they seem to be able to find gold." And according to verses 10 through 12 of our reading, that's what Naaman seems to think of the River Jordan when Elisha advocates that he dip himself up to 7 times in it. He considers the River Jordan far inferior to the rivers of his own capital city, Damascus, and his pride and his prejudice don't stop there. After his healing, he tries to pay the prophet, but in verse 16, Elisha refuses to accept any gift or payment whatever. For him, as he tells the king of Israel in verse 8, it's sufficient that his ministry be vindicated in Naaman's healing and that the God who has made all of this possible be glorified. According to verses 13 through 16, the final saving grace for Naaman is that he does not allow his pride and his false expectations to prevent him from carrying out Elisha's advice. Again, on the suggestion of his household, Naaman actually humbles himself in the Jordan and he keeps his money to himself for the time being when Elisha insists. Not only that, but when he's healed and his skin becomes clean and healthy again, he sees where kingly praise is ultimately due. And that's to God alone. Between 1991 and 2007, Fuller Theological Seminary in California conducted a survey of 750 Muslims who had converted to Christianity. They represented 50 ethnic groups from 30 different countries, and the reasons why they said they had come to faith were very interesting. Some were more predictable, like hearing of God's unconditional love, or seeing Christians practice what they preached. Others were perhaps less so, and they included the observation that the prayers of Christians had healed the sick and delivered others from demonic powers. The New Testament makes it very clear that the healings of Jesus and others were explicitly intended as signs and wonders. Why so? To witness to God's supernatural and saving power. And that continues to this day, of course. And that, in Old Testament terms at least, is also what happens to Naaman. Because once he has been healed, in verse 15, we hear him making what amounts to the confession of a converted man. "Now I know," he says, "that there is no God in all the earth except in Israel." Now I know that there is no God in all the earth except in Israel. But how does Naaman reach that point? As we've seen, in order for him to receive healing and find new faith, Elisha insists that he willingly sacrifice almost every form of pride and prejudice he could imagine. In one single episode or series of events, the prophet directly confounds Naaman's concerns for public position, personal independence, national pride, household authority, and common business sense. And it's only after such a humbling process that the general is finally ready to be healed and to proclaim his conversion to the God of Israel. So it's important to realize that Naaman might never have come that far at all had Elisha not been firm as well as compassionate in his dealings with him. Because Naaman was an enemy, Elisha may not have particularly welcomed the prospect of ministering to the general at all. But he chose compassion over convenience and volunteered his services. Faced with his proud independence, it would surely have been easier for Elisha to have made the situation less challenging for Naaman. He might have suggested a less demeaning cure or accepted payment for his services, but he chose strength over compromise and held his ground. So seen in its entirety, the account of Naaman with Elisha is much more than that of a simple healing and conversion. It's the story of a man of power, wealth, and position who is humbled by illness to seek a cure from God and from Elisha, his minister. It's the account of a soldier who must request help from a representative of his enemy, and a general who must listen to the advice of his household. It's the story of a man who, when brought to such a pass, finds his pride and his prejudice directly challenged by a simple prophet. It's the account of a Syrian who must obey an Israelite, a man of no faith, who, when he finally submits to the right way of doing things, finds faith in the one true God who has miraculously healed him and continues to heal by the power of the Holy Spirit today. Last but not least, it's the story of a faithful minister who refuses to compromise in offering tough love to a man who badly needs it. So our reading raises many issues that can be true to our own experience. How often have we found ourselves humbled by the need to seek healing and wholeness as Naaman was, only to discover that God's remedy wasn't exactly what we expected? How many of us only came to faith as Naaman did, when we reached a point of real crisis in our lives? How often have we also been challenged when God has turned our pride and our prejudice on its head? Or when God has asked us to do things that we once thought beneath or beyond us, like Naaman bathing in the River Jordan? There's a great deal that can strike a chord in the story of Naaman and Elisha. But like any biblical passage, it also raises questions, of course. And I want to close by focusing on two key issues in particular. The first concerns our dealings with others. If we're members or regular attenders of Ebenezer or any other biblical church, we will tend to recognize that we are all God's or Christ's ministers. Thankfully, the days are long gone when pastors like me were expected to do everything. We may not be exercising a healing ministry to army generals. We may not be evangelists to the rich and famous. We may not be mixing with heads of state or senior politicians. We may even be grateful that God has not called us to such a work. But we all have responsibilities to those we encounter through church, to our families, to our neighbors, to our workmates, to our fellow students. And we have probably all known hard cases or challenging individuals. And what does the story of Naaman and Elisha have to teach us about how to deal with such people? I would suggest that it provides a clear model of tough love in action. It shows how it's possible to blend conviction with compassion as we reach out in love without compromise and without being swayed by the unreasonable demands or expectations of others. The second issue can be much more personal because it concerns our individual relationships with God. And I guess that the main questions that strike me here are, how open are we being with God? How open are you being with God? Or more directly, how much are you prepared to give up to allow God to minister healing in your life? There can be all kinds of barriers that we put up. Perhaps our fear of losing face, or maybe our self-image. Sometimes we can be hindered by guilt or shame, or we may try to protect families or friends. Sometimes plain old-fashioned pride or prejudice can get in our way. Whatever our individual issues, and we all have them, the example of Elisha and Naaman can surely encourage us towards greater openness and transparency before God. Wherever and however we desire healing in our lives, physical, psychological, spiritual, or otherwise, we are unlikely to find it unless we admit our needs and are prepared to do what God requires of us. But if, like Naaman, we are ready to set our personal agendas aside to receive the ministry that God has in mind, we may, like him, discover truly miraculous results. For our God is a God of healing and miracles, who delights to do good things for us, as Jesus tells another leper seeking healing in Mark chapter 1, verse 40, when he says, "If you are willing, you can make me clean." "I am willing. I am willing," Jesus says, and then he heals him. God did the same for Naaman through Elisha, and God can do it for us too. For as the famous preacher Donald Gray Barnhouse once remarked, in the final analysis, Christ sends none away empty, but those who are full of themselves. Christ sends none away empty, but those who are full of themselves. All that he requires is that we turn to him, that we do so in heartfelt trust and faith, and that we be ready to humble ourselves enough to receive his healing grace into whatever area of our life most needs it. Let's bow our heads. Loving God, we do thank you for the way that these powerful stories written so long ago can still speak to us, and for the reminder through today's reading of how you call us to be ready to lay aside our pride and our prejudice, whatever comes between us and you, in order to enter more freely and fully into relationship with you and to become more of what you created us to be. Whatever issues we may be struggling with today, Lord, you know them better than we do. Help us to be open, to be transparent before you. Help us to be ready to set aside all barriers, everything that interferes with drawing closer to you and receiving your healing love and grace. So as we open our hearts now, Lord, minister to us, we pray, by the power of your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen.
Just as I am, without one plea.
Praise God.
just as I am.
Let us pray. Loving God, as we come before you today, we give thanks for all your grace and goodness to us and to all people. We're especially thankful for our families and friends, and for the precious gift of being part of your family, the Church. Thank you that we are your children, adopted by grace through faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, who made the perfect sacrifice to bring us home. Build us together and build us up as your people, we pray, so that we may grow in grace and glorify you as we share in your ministry of reaching out with the good news of the gospel. We are so blessed that you ask us to lift our cares and concerns, as well as our thanksgivings, to you in prayer. Yet even as we do that, Lord, we acknowledge that you are a loving, holy God who wants to relieve our burdens and enable us to receive your forgiveness. Thank you that you are faithful and just when we come to you like the prodigal, saying, I am no longer worthy to be called your son or daughter. I have sinned against heaven and before you. Thank you that you, our kind and merciful Father, promise to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So we say, have mercy upon us, as we confess our sins of thought, word, and deed against you and against one another. We ask you to pardon and deliver us from all our sins, to confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and to keep us in eternal life. Loving God, you have taught us in your word that the prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. So as your word invites us, we lift up the needs of our world, especially during this COVID-19 pandemic. We pray for peace and justice on earth and for the poor, the hungry, and the oppressed. We ask you to restore to wholeness whatever is broken by human sin in our lives, in our nation, and in the world. We remember the leaders of the nations, including our own, praying that you would grant them knowledge and wisdom and guide and direct them in their decision-making. We pray for the leaders of this church. Help us to make wise and prudent decisions and to have clarity of mind and vision. Give us patience and wisdom, and grant us a spirit of humility and unity in Christ as we seek to be servants of the servants of God. Lord, even as we rejoice with those who rejoice, we also mourn with those who mourn for whatever reason. And we're so thankful that you are the Father of compassion and the God of all comfort to us all. So we ask your healing grace for all who are sick, injured, or disabled, that they may be made whole. Please give to all who seek your guidance and to all who are lonely, anxious, or depressed, a knowledge of your will and an awareness of your presence. Mend broken relationships and restore those in emotional distress to soundness of mind and serenity of spirit. Bless physicians, nurses, and all who minister to the suffering, granting them wisdom and skill, sympathy and patience, especially at this challenging time. Grant to the dying peace and a holy death, and uphold by the grace and consolation of your Spirit those who are bereaved. Be especially with those who are on our hearts right now, those who have asked us to pray for them, and those whom we have forgotten. We praise you that you are the Lord who does wonders. You have declared your power among the peoples. With you, O Lord, is the well of life, and in your light we see light. So we ask you to hear us, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, to whom be honor, glory, and power, both now and forevermore. We pray all this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word.
Jesus. trust him
more. And as we come to the close of this time of worship, I'd like to thank everyone who has chosen to join us whenever and wherever you happen to be with us. If you want to know more about Ebenezer Baptist Church here in Vancouver, please go to our website, rockofhelp.com. Even as we return to online services only, at least for the next couple of weeks and perhaps beyond that, please remember that other activities continue. And if you look again at our website, you'll find that there is a women's prayer meeting, for example, on Wednesday evening, that there is a Bible study on the Psalms that continues on Friday, and this coming Saturday, we hope to have a gathering of youth and young adults to play games. All of that online on Zoom, and you'll find the access details on our website. Today, we have talked about some important issues concerning our relationship with God and indeed with others. Because the story of Elisha and Naaman has reminded us just how important it is to be open before God, to be willing to swallow our pride where necessary, with the thought that it's as we do that, as we open ourselves, as we seek God, that God, we are most open to God's ministry among us. Whatever you're struggling with right now, I would encourage you to do that, to turn especially to Jesus Christ, to ask his ministry in your life, and to place your burdens at the foot of his cross, the cross on which he died before he rose again to save us all by grace through faith from our sins. And now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you now and remain with you always. Amen. Just now.